pray with me. May these words of my mouth and this meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Grace and peace to you from God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Today, we continue to consider how we can carry the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, in our own lives, in our own community. Last week, inspired by Cliff Murray, we spoke of the inner peace that is to be found when we reconcile our lives with our relationship with God. How we are called to bring all of who we are to God as an offering of devotion, an offering that will transform us and better allow us to reach out to others who are suffering in the ways that we may have suffered. This experience of forgiveness and acceptance, our journey from brokenness towards wholeness, will bear us the wisdom we need to love others as we find ourselves being loved by our amazing God. We will do the same today. Our church sign facing 3rd Marian today reads, "Plant smiles, grow giggles, harvest love." That's one formula for carrying the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. And honestly, I like it. It's catchy, it's simple, it's cute, and it's succinct. It even seems kind of happy, focusing on smiles, giggles, and love. What kind of ogre would be anti-smiles, anti-giggles, or anti-love? But that's not what we hear coming from John the Baptizer in our gospel reading today, though I don't necessarily think he was an ogre. It seems actually to be a million miles away from the tone and the intention of Jesus' most famous cousin, and he just doesn't sound very loving. And this passage, this piece of the story that we heard read today, is just before John baptizes Jesus, one of the most well-known scenes from the Gospels in all of Christendom. When John baptizes Jesus, the Gospel famously reports that the heavens open and the Spirit of God descends like a dove, and then the voice of God says, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." Most of us have seen dramatic reenactments of this part of the life of Christ on television or in the movies. And this scene is always lit with a sacred and beautiful light. The dove is always glowing in the white of righteousness, coming down as the Holy Spirit, and everyone in the crowd is awestruck and amazed by the sheer sight of it. It always looks like it's portrayed as being holy and sacred, like a coronation. Jesus declared by the voice of God to be the Son of God, and thus the Messiah, the one who will deliver the world into a new age of peace and justice. And yet in the Gospel of Matthew here, just before one of the most holy and symbolic moments in the life of Jesus, it just doesn't seem all that sacred and holy. This scene between John the Baptizer and the crowds at the River Jordan just isn't very loving either. John the Baptizer standing in the river sounds more like the stereotypical mad doomsday prophet than a loving disciple. He speaks of judgment. His words have a sense of urgency to them, like everyone needs to hurry up and get on with it because they are running out of time. He does begin with, "Repent, for the kingdom of God has come near." He sounds angry to me, like he should be screaming rather than simply talking, and certainly not speaking in a soft and reverent whisper, "We brood of vipers." Doesn't fit. We are told that he looks a sight, too, that he wears clothing of camel's hair with but a leather belt around his waist. was but locusts and honey. So we assume he's wandering in the wilderness, surviving off the land, ranting and raving to all who will listen. He is a wild man with a wild message. I assume that he is prone to extremes, very charismatic, driven by his beliefs. I don't see this particular version of John the Baptizer to be very fun-loving and laid back. I see him being very serious and intentional with everything he does. So what's with all the name-calling and the threat of unquenchable fire? Well, as usual, there's more to the story. We need to realize just where the writers of the Gospel of Matthew have placed their version of John the Baptizer. The geography has a voice in this story that many of us today may not hear as clearly as a group of first century Jews wandering the wilderness of Judea looking for a prophet. This is my homemade map. I hope you all can see it. This is the Mediterranean Sea. This little blob of blue here is the Sea of Galilee. This little squiggly line coming all the way down is the blessed River Jordan. And this little blob of blue down here is the Dead Sea. If you look at an ancient version of this map, you'll see that odds are, scholars say, John the Baptist was just to the east side of the Jordan River, right where it runs into the Dead Sea. And if you look straight across that river, there sits the famed city of Jericho, and that's just something we need to know. In relation, if you go on down like a little crescent, from Jericho you will see Jerusalem, Bethlehem, Gaza, and Hebron, where the patriots, or patriarchs, excuse me, are buried. In a modern map, this part, still divided down the middle of the Sea of Galilee, the River Jordan, and the Dead Sea, just like a couple of thousand years ago, ironically, is Egypt, or Egypt, Israel. Egypt is down here, Lebanon is here, Syria is here, and Jordan is here. But in our time, what's good to know is that this is the wilderness. This is the River Jordan that they crossed to get into the Promised Land, and this is the city of Jericho. But this, my little dove, is where we are today. The traditional site, scholars believe to be where all of this happened, the baptism of Jesus and this brood of viper speech, is likely a place which we now call Wadi al-Bahar, and it is located on the east side of the Jordan River, just north of the Dead Sea. That would certainly place John in the Judean wilderness at that time in the first century, and he would be facing towards Judea, where the crowds would be coming from, and as they would be coming to him on their travels, and what he would be looking out towards as he is speaking, is the legendary city of Jericho. The city with walls so thick that no enemy, it was once said, could ever break them. And yet most of us know from the song, you know, how's that, right? Josh fought the battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho. Josh fought the battle of Jericho, and the walls came tumbling down. I tried. But now, why did those walls fall down? Because the power of God was with the people of Israel. They had just crossed the River Jordan themselves, finally entering into the Promised Land. And when they entered the Promised Land, they found that there were already people living there. But God told them that if they were obedient to God's laws, and if they followed God's commands, that they would be victorious. Now, there's a lot more to the story than that. But just as we know the story about the walls of Jericho that came tumbling down today, so did that crowd standing on the banks of the River Jordan as a symbol of God's steadfast faithfulness to the people who are in a right relationship with God. And that's what's speaking through this entire scene with John the Baptizer and these people standing on the shore of the river in this reading. If you are faithful to God, God will be faithful to you. It may not always be easy. It may not always be what you expect. But God will always be with you, even in the most difficult and impossible of times. And God will not always be with you, and God will not only always be with you, but God will help you to realize things that you never even thought were possible. The impossible is possible through a right relationship with God. Where some see hopelessness and despair, the faithful are called to see hope and opportunity. Like the wandering people coming finally after 40 years crossing the desert into their promised land, only to find it inhabited by people who could possibly mean them harm and enslave them. The crowd of curious seekers suffering under the boot of Roman-occupied Palestine, who dared to believe that they could be relieved of the incredulous taxation and second-class citizenship that, as Jews, they were forced to live under as a part of Rome's control over their lives and culture. The promise of God to the faithful has always been the same. I am here and I am coming. There is a new way, a new age, a new heaven and a new earth that is coming in my wake. But this new age, the coming of the Messiah, the salvation of the world, it's not just going to happen all by itself. We are not going to be standing on the sidelines as some apocalyptic sci-fi Jesus Christ sweeps down from on high and cleans house. We are called to be a part of the reckoning. We are called to be an active part of the coming of the new age of righteousness and peace and justice. That's why John the Baptizer calls the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the holy men of his time, a brood of vipers or the son of snakes. Because as holy men of their time, standing there listening to John call on the crowd to repent, which means to turn away from the wrongs of the world and turn towards the right living that a genuine relationship with God so graciously affords us. Men like that, men with power, men with privilege, tend to hide behind their position and their prestige and not get their hands dirty. They don't want to get involved. They don't want to be too political or risk causing a stir. And to that, John says that while he may be baptizing with water, the one to come after him will baptize with fire. He portrays Jesus as the Messiah, as a farmer harvesting grain. He says that those who repent are the wheat separated from the chaff that will be stored in the granary to be used as life-giving nourishment for the new age to come. But those who do not repent, even those who claim to be holier than thou with their religious ceremony and practices in the temple itself, without repenting themselves, without stepping up to be a part of the great coming of the kingdom of God, will be nothing more than the chaff that any wheat farmer has no use for, and thus will be burnt in the harvest fires at the end of the threshing season. Strong words to prove a beautifully simple and strong message. That you cannot simply profess to believe in your faith. You have to live into it. Your faith and your relationship with God should guide you into doing new things for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of the great coming of the kingdom of God. When you repent, you're not just saying, here is where I have been a bad person, or here is what I've done wrong, and, well, God, simply not enough, I'm afraid. Not enough for him, not enough for the Messiah, and not enough for our amazing God. Here, to repent is to turn towards God. With your whole life and everything that you do for the sake of peace and justice and for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And not just for yourself, but for everyone, friend and foe alike, for yourself and for your neighbor, for the whole world. This week, we lost a great man. Nelson Mandela died, and the world mourns his passing. A legend, they say, one of the most significant figures of the 20th century, they say. One of the many things that made Nelson Mandela a very great man is that he walked a path that led him out of one of the most oppressive and morally corrupt societies on earth, that being apartheid, a system of racial segregation, and into a new way of living, a new world for the South African people that for far too long, many generations thought simply was not possible. But his journey, his story, the witness he bore as he worked for justice with the African National Congress, to his 27 years of imprisonment for the sake of the movement, to his ascendancy as the nation's first black president after the fall of apartheid. It did many things. And for me, it bore a message of hope and opportunity. His life, all of it, his struggle, his faithfulness to a belief in the right for all people to have the opportunity to experience peace and justice and fairness in their lives, not only led a movement to free a nation from its own prejudiced tyranny, but also gave the world the power of knowing that if it is possible there, that it can be possible anywhere. The experience of healing and wholeness, the experience of forgiveness and reconciliation that we often speak of in our personal relationships with God and each other in our faith, in this room, is possible for whole communities of people, for entire nations, for even the world, even here in Elkhart, even here in Indiana. The power of God is real, and the justice and peace and grace and mercy and new life await everyone willing to dare, to risk, to believe. That's what John the Baptizer is trying to say here, with all of the drama and rhetoric in the sightlines of the rubble of the walls of Jericho, standing in the very river the chosen people crossed to realize the great promise made by God to Abraham. But some people will readily say, yeah, that sounds good and all, but you just can't change people. You know, people are going to do what they are going to do, and they're going to believe what they are going to believe. Perhaps John would say, and I know Paul would say, oh ye of little faith. But Mandela would say, as he did in his book, Long Walk to Freedom, no one is born hating another person because of the color of his skin, or his background, or his religion. People must learn to hate. And if they can learn to hate, they can be taught to love. For love comes more naturally to the human heart than its opposite. So there it is for us today. We need to be willing to repent, to turn our lives wholly towards our amazing God. And when we do this, when we pray for the faith to let this experience change us, empower us to act on behalf of the gospel, to work for justice and freedom and peace and mercy and grace in this world. Because when we do, we are answering the call to do our part to be the wheat and not the chaff, to be active in the work of God in our world, to bring about that great and glorious day with the righteousness of God, that being steadfast and unconditional love and respect for all of God's children, is realized, Your Honor. Have you ever wondered what would happen if people simply stopped believing whatever they believed in? Like if everyone just lost their faith or their drive or their purpose all at once, all on the same day. Nobody believed in anything. What sort of world would we be left with? What if Nelson Mandela gave up when he was sitting in prison for 27 years? Can you imagine? I don't want to. This line of thought raises a good question for us to end with. Are you limiting the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ in your life? Are you afraid of what you do not know, of what you cannot know, and what you cannot control? That being what will happen, whatever it is, if you let the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ change your life. And are you ready to set that power free? Are you ready to trust in the Lord and to give it a go, to see what happens? I'm here to urge you today to do so, to repent. To repent like you're listening to John the Baptizer on the banks of the River Jordan yourself. To turn your life towards God, and then don't ever look back. To live your life in God's love, and work to find ways to share that love with everyone you meet. It could be collecting food for the food pantry, or volunteering at church community services. You could join a political action campaign and work for the rights of all of our citizens, because we are all God's children. You can even make it a goal to knit 100 scarves for needy children in our community to keep them warm this winter, like Diane Dahl did. Do something for the sake of the gospel. Because when you do, you will be carrying the gospel to others, leading others into a life-giving relationship with God by what you do, even more so than anything you could ever say. And when you act in love, it's contagious. Your inner Christ light will shine, and that light will transform others and bear witness to our amazing God. It will lead others to a relationship with Christ. Nelson Mandela once also said, "And we let our own light shine, and we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same." So let the light of the gospel set your heart aflame with the love of God through your acts of faith. Let your light shine. And all of God's people said amen.